Non-existent. yoga, this is a way of realization. Try and imagine what it will be like to go to sleep and never wake up. Think about that. Children, love. It's one of the great wonders of life. What will it be like to go to sleep and never wake up? And if you think long enough about that, something will happen. You will find out, among other things, that to pose the next question to you, what was it like to wake up after having never gone to sleep? That was when you were born. You see, you can't have an experience of nothing. Nature abhors that. So after you are dead, the only thing that can happen is the same experience, or the same sort of experience as when you were born. In other words, we all know very well that after people die, other people are born. And they're all you. example, that there is a permanent and eternal self in each one of us, and clung to that self. The Buddha, in order to counteract this one-sided view, taught the other extreme doctrine that there is no fixed self in us, no ego. But a Mahayanist would always say, the truth is the middle way. Neither sukha nor dukkha, neither atman nor anatman, self nor non-self. The whole point is like this. Once when R.H. Blythe was asked by some students, do you believe in God? He answered, if you do, I don't. If you don't, I do. And so in the much the same way, all Buddhist pedagogics, teaching, is specifically addressed not to people in general, but to the individual who brings a problem. And wherever he seems to be overemphasizing things in one way, the teacher overemphasizes in the opposite way, so as to arrive at the middle way. So then, with this emphasis on life is suffering, it's simply saying, this is the problem we're dealing with. We hurt. We human beings feel pretty unfairly treated because we are born into a world so arranged that the price that we pay for enjoying it, that is to say, for having sensitive bodies, is that these bodies are at the same time, because they are sensitive, capable of the most excruciating agonies. Isn't that a nasty trick to play on us? What are we going to do about it? This is the problem. So then when the Buddha says, the cause of suffering is desire, Krishna is our word thirst, and may perhaps be translated desire in a very general sense, or perhaps better, craving, clinging, grasping, something like that. He is saying, now I'm going to make this suggestion. You suffer because you desire. Now supposing then you try not to desire, and see if by not desiring, can cease from suffering. Or you can put the same thing in another way. You can say to a person, it's all in your mind. There is nothing either good or ill. Thinking makes it so. And therefore, if you can control your mind, you've nothing else that you need control. For example, you don't need to control the rain. Control your mind. If you get wet, it's only your mind that makes you think it's uncomfortable to be wet. A person who's got good mental discipline can be perfectly happy wandering around in the rain. You don't need a fire if you've got good mind control. Because if you've got ordinary bad mind control, when it gets cold, you start shivering. That's because you're putting up a resistance to the cold. You're fighting it. But don't fight it. Relax to the cold. And in other words, this is a matter of mental attitude, and then you'll be fine. Always control your mind.